Kamara, where you are. Today we have the opportunity to speak to Ghana's former president, His Excellency John Ejekunkufo. We have an opportunity to get to know him up close and personal, beyond how we have known him as a political figure in this country. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you for coming.
So you've been out of office for about 8 months now. What have you been doing?
Traveling around the world.
Oh.
Of course, not just for traveling sake. Undertaking assignments from the World Bank, World Food Programme, the African Union, the Commonwealth, some foundation from North Africa around the land.
It sounds like you've been busy. I would have thought that after 8 years of hectic work, you took a bit of a break.
Well, I want to take a bit of a break, but I didn't want to just fall out of the scene altogether. Because people, or the world would perhaps begin to forget me. So I needed to sort of break into retirement gradually.
Okay.
To do that, I needed to accept these invitations.
So tell me about your engagement, for instance, with the World Food Programme.
Well, they invited me to accept to be a global ambassador against hunger. It's a huge title, a global ambassador. And of course, who wants hunger? Especially on the continent of Africa, where it's suffered for far too long. And if, say, an organization like the World Food Programme would invite me to advocate to help them get more resources so they come to the relief of hungry people all over the world, I'm also Africa. My daughter, it was a godly offer I shouldn't tender.
So typically, what do you do? What is your job?
It's only a month or so back, they gave me this assignment. And immediately after, this was in North Italy, I went to London, where I was interviewed by the BBC, both television and radio, and also by CNN and Al Jazeera. And the whole idea that I should play a lead advocate to the world, especially to leaders around the world, to focus them on the necessity to support the purpose of the program, that putting together resources to support the needy of the world, especially in terms of getting food, providing food security.
When the new Patriotic Party government assumed power in January 2001, under the dynamic leadership of President, did not defeat them before. It was realized that the seat of government and presidency did not defeat the worldwide high position Ghana has attained. As you are all no doubt aware, at independence in 1957, the new government inherited an office and a residency that was originally a trading post of our colonial masters. Not only was it a trading post for goods, but it was unfortunately also a trading post for human beings. No wonder it was referred to by some as the slave caste.
Must not be forgotten that the Osu Castle has not fulfilled and indeed can never provide such a center because it was physically and historically purpose-built as a slaving outpost. And indeed, it continues to bear the indelible scars and stigma of that inhuman trade of those times. If anybody doubted the urgency of providing the nation with such a nerve center, he or she should look at the mystical appeal of examples like the White House of the United States of America, the Buckingham Palace of Great Britain, the Elysee Palace of France, the Kremlin of Russia, and coming closer to home, the Aso Rock of Nigeria, and the Executive Mansion of Liberia. Perhaps the question to ask in the case of Ghana is why, since independence, from President Nkrumah to current times, none of our leaders could make a home of Yosu Castle. The decision to construct a new seat of government, including a residence for the president, has generated a very robust debate in the country. Unfortunately, more often than not, the debate has been tainted with partisan sentiments. At no time has government overlooked the challenges that the critics have tended to overplay. Perhaps the history of how government took the decision to go ahead with the development will help calm any anxieties that might be lingering anywhere in the country. Nananom, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Soon after I assumed office in the year 2001, I took the initiative to launch several contacts within the community of development partners and friendly nations to try to raise the needed resources to meet this felt need of the nation. It was not till the fourth year that the government received an offer of a very soft-terms loan from the government of India, with a 50% grant element at an interest of just 1.75% and a repayment period of 25 years, including a moratorium of 5 years. It was an irresistible offer, which I considered God sent for Ghana. These terms at once offered a golden opportunity to the nation to develop the much-needed national house timelessly.
The president is a man at the moment in charge of the state. And then he decided that, as opposed to other things that people felt were felt needs, this was not a felt need. It was also part of the alternative. So he chose this. So I cannot fault it. Yes. But that does not mean that those who opposed this themselves wouldn't want to use it. Our concerns as NDC were simple. The concerns were the parliament where we raised was our cost. And nobody in NDC
all of you
has said that we'll use this place for the hospital or we'll use it for a portrait farm. For me, anybody who will say that might have a side examine
must be seen as the house of the nation, the first of its kind, specifically done for the purpose of housing the seats of government. Accordingly, the nation must dedicate it to God as its blessing. The major attraction for deciding to use this site was the Black Star House, which President Nkrumah and his family moved into when he decided the castle was not suitable for the president. I am proud that this project has been extended to cover the restoration of the Flagstaff House, which which is undoubtedly a heritage property. That part of the complex will henceforth be known as Kuruma's Heritage House. The hope is that it will serve to enlighten our people about our first president and the history of the beginning of our nationhood, and also of the pivotal role Ghana played in the freedom movement across the continent of Africa. Fellow citizens, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I should at this stage reiterate once more the nation's and my own gratitude to the government and people of India for the generosity of support given to Ghana building this architecturally unique complex. Nananom, Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is now my singular honor and pleasant duty to declare the Golden Jubilee House duly commissioned. God bless this house and all of us. Thank you.
Hey, Mom. Yo, that's a guy. One bunch of more will die now. Come work here for a fish. Work at Chunek and Chimo Blue. Come back to
the labor. The work of our hands and the work of our minds. Grant that all those who will perform business and all those who will plan.
Right on your left.
As a continue from our first presidency to the current presidency. The landmarks are most interesting because we've preserved Nkrumah's old legacy. You remember in the 1960s, and I'm sure you are very well aware of the history of the days, we were giving the impression that Nkrumah was utterly extravagant in having moved to Flagstaff House and having lived in the house, which now looks utterly modest in all its ramifications. And then we have this edifice. It's extraordinary. Extraordinary in its content, extraordinary in its architecture, and extraordinary in the concept upon which it was based. When this site was located for the presidency, it caused a lot of problems. The army thought they were being denied a choice location. The opposition parties thought this was, as I said earlier, an extravagant choice of location. And then, in our traditional feeling, when Nkrumah was overthrown, we were giving all kinds of stories that Kwame Nkrumah had decapitated a lot of heads into his house there to give him protection and so on. But all of those have turned out to be false. And we have this to prove that modernity in thinking has its place and it helps to bring people into a more creative thinking. I think we've been creative. And I'm happy we have this to show.
At least I'm told. All the way. Once I accept humanity, I have.